show started. Then let's see some IWE wrestling.
As we're seeing an immediate test of strength going in this match.
And you see the strain on the Direwolf's face as he was trying his hardest to fend off Sam Hex.
It was looking like they were about even there, but just leaving the motion of the wrist one way or the other was enough for Hex to really have a little bit of the advantage.
And now a collar elbow tie up. Both men trying to vie for position.
The technician's game going into the arm wrench here for Mr. Kerr.
And really putting the added strain on the shoulder joint by dropping the elbow. You can see Sam Hex trying to get back to his feet, trying to get a steady basis. Wanted to go for a strike, but Kerr just wrenching harder, bringing Hex back down to the mat, down to one knee.
And I'm curious, at what point will this be too much for Hex here?
Oh, and now into a headlock. It looked like Hex was trying to get any limb he possibly could to break that hold. And off the ropes go Kerr. Shoulder tackle. In for the cover. One. And a kick out after one.
Hit him more than the knees into Hex.
Very smart move by Kerr. Even right after the pin, just getting right back up and getting right back on the attack.
Keep it up with the offense.
And following up with an uppercut.
He's thinking he might be it. He's getting a little cocky in this match for our opening contest with BattleZone TV.
Absolutely. He's been dominating this match for most of it besides that intro. I mean, he has a reason to be confident, but hang on, chop block coming from Hex.
As soon as he turned his back, it was enough.
Yep, it's one of those things where you gotta be careful not to get too cocky, because then something like this will happen, and the tides turn in a wrestling match so quickly, you just saw it in a flash. And now really working on the leg, the left leg of Kerr is Sam Hex. The crowd trying to will Cory back into it, trying to get him to break the hold and help him in any way they can. And now an assault just on the right leg.
He's been able to bust open that submission. Hex looking to be changing this match around now that we got an even playing field between these two men. But how much damage was done to that leg is the question for
Absolutely.
Sam Kerr, or Cory Kerr, I'm sorry.
And now Hex back on the attack. Bring Cory back up to a vertical base, setting him to the corner. Oh! And a stinging chop. Another one right in the corner. And it looks like they're going from corner to corner to corner.
Now they're at the corner closest to us as he is getting the boot right in the throat. Sam Hex with a deep stretch into the neck of Kerr.
And he used almost that full five count, breaking it only at four from the referee.
Hex taking his time with his opponent here.
He wants to be sure that even though he's in control, that he saves himself and doesn't overstrain himself in a situation where he's not sure if he can win it just yet. And again, almost using that full five count.
I mean, we saw earlier what happened when Kerr was having to deal with a huge advantage. Oh, looks like he's going to go for the straitjacket. He's got his fingers
on the rope. Luckily enough for Corey, he was close enough to the ropes right there that even though his arm was wrenched so far back, he was still able to get his fingertips on the ropes. And I went back to work on that leg. And the pain and agony coming out of Cory Kerr. Again, trying to get to that rope. Just fingertips away from it right now. And he grabs it. It's one of those situations where you have like these big men in the ring together using a submission hold like that. It's difficult to keep them away from the ropes to be able to allow for the submission to take its full effect. And again, back into that submission.
Well, you're not mentioning the fact that these are bigger men. That takes so much more for them to stand up to be able to keep any form of balance compared to say an A. Wicked or a J.J. Hughes.
Right. And he's tapping. And the submission was just too much to handle for Cory Kerr. And in a debut match.
And our winner is Sam Hacks.
And in his debut match, Sam Hacks coming off strong after defeating another debut from Cory Kerr. It's one of those things where even though he's wrestling another debuting gladiator here in IWE, it makes a statement. It puts the rest of the roster on notice just to know, hey, I need to look out for that guy. And that's exactly what Sam Hacks was looking to do. But still a good showing coming from Corey. As he's helped back to the back by the referee, the severe damage to that leg that happened during the match, we can only hope he's going to be able to return at the next episode and that the damage isn't too bad. A good showing coming from him.
I'm Pink Daddy Dollar, the human stimulus package. Skills to pay the bills, and I brought in these two for one reason and one reason only, the team ratings, and I'm gonna let Alex Steele tell you exactly what that reason is.
Sure thing, Pete. Listen up, Jack Wagons, and listen good. You are looking at the best tag team in professional wrestling today. I'm talking about the package, Andrew Steele. I'm talking about Cannonball Alex Steele. We are the Steele Brothers. Steel Forge in the hometown of Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, my man. And I don't care if we got to go through the Nick Baker and Bill Blackwell, the candlestick maker, whatever that guy thinks he is. I don't care if we got to go through the Sons of Sanity. And I don't care if we got to go through the IWE Tag Team Champions, Team Dumb and Dumber, Dungeons and Doofus, whatever the heck their names are. We are going to throw our weight around. This man's going to tie you up in a whole bunch of knots, and I'm going to get inside your head, and then I'm going to jump on your head. Tell him, Package.
I'll let my wrestling do the talking.
Well, moving forward here on this episode of BattleZone TV, our next matchup is one with the most severe bad blood. You see making his way to the ring, De Oro, Roberto Cruz.
We saw last episode that these two individuals agreed, along with Jordan McGee, to sit down, that this would be the final battle between Roberto Cruz and Man Grizzlee. True professionalism.
Well, if it's any consolation of trying to figure out how professionally is he is in the ring and what he determines to be a professional, you are nothing of such.
Hey, someone is here hitting here purple and a little gray suit. That's not professional. Come on now.
Yeah, it is. Good size purple and gray, man. This feud.
as we said, this is going to be the final battle between these two individuals.
Like we're just about ready to get this match underway. And here we go in this final contest between Bam and Roberto Cruz. These two men, after debuting, have both proven themselves to be extremely well-rounded wrestlers here in IWE. And I have to say, I'm super excited to see the finish of this match. Oh, a neck breaker. Tandem offense coming from Bam. Going for that senton and misses wildly. And now Cruz taking advantage with strikes to the back.
Immediately, we're already seeing these two guys going in a full blast. This is kind of the thing that really created the tension between them. The emotion. They're not going to hold anything back in this final battle.
No, not at all. And off the ropes goes Cruz, and a shoulder tackle brings Bam Grizzlee back down to the mat. Off the ropes, ducks the clothesline.
Oh.
And a clothesline by Bam. Off the ropes, going for another senton. This one connects. In for the cover, one, two, and a kick out after two. Forearm in the face nonetheless. That's where you can see the real disdain that Bam Grizzlee has for Roberto Cruz. Off the ropes goes Cruz. Oh, a big clothesline.
Looked like he was howling on his head there.
In for the cover. One, two, and another kick out after two. Bam Grizzlee has just enough energy to stay in this match. But he looks dazed.
I can only imagine Roberto Cruz is feeling that he should have not only won the match, but he knows just by in the battles with Bam Grizzlee that wouldn't be enough. He wants to finish this perhaps in the way of making sure Bam won't even have to challenge anyone else in IWE again.
And a big forearm from Cruz into a running bulldog and in for the cover. One, two, and another kick out after two. Again, Bam Grizzlee staying in this match.
I'm just curious what the effects from that beatdown that we don't know that Bam Grizzlee said when Roberto Cruz attacked him at the tip up over the top event.
Oh!
And how much of a factor that could play into this match.
Oh! And an uppercut with the hanging on the ropes, and Bam Grizzlee goes to the outside.
Who's the man?
Cruz now making his way to the outside of the ring. He's trying to cut off Bam before he gets a chance to gain any energy. And off that ring apron, the hardest part of the ring. Oh, now into a ring pose. An Irish whip with extra vigor.
Good work, good work.
Referee's now at a count of five, and Cruz is back in the ring. Six.
Bam still got life in him.
Bam slowly making his way in and breaks the count. But Cruz going right back after Bam. Snapmare. Uh-oh. Oh, and the fake out. We expected a huge strike coming from Cruz, and he just goes right into that shoulder hold.
Classic Roberto Cruz there, putting in that nerve hold, really tearing it down the shoulder and his arm and his neck.
That area is some of the most tender tissue that you have, and it's the most sensitive. It can be so painful and just destroying all your nerves. Up and over, and oh, right hands from Bam. He's wailing, ducks the clothesline. Oh! And a bit of a pop-up uppercut. Sam stirring a little bit just because it looked like he didn't get a lot of air out of it. But still connecting hard, stopped Bam right in his tracks. But still trying to fight back. His fighting spirit will not die in this match.
I can imagine if this was any other match, he might be done, but the fuel, the rage building in both these men are pushing him to another limit.
And into the corner again, and Cruz just barely missing it. It's kick right into the corner. Now Bam rallying off the ropes. Elbow right to the face. Just dropping Cruz one after another. Oh! And that sit down neck breaker.
This could be it. Bam. Where's Bam going?
Looks like Bam's going up to the top rope. He's here to put Cruz out for good at this point. Oh! Elbow dropping Cruz dodged.
You just can't really do that with Roberto Cruz. Roberto Cruz is too smart for that kind of thing. Come on.
But in a match of this caliber, you got to be willing to try anything. Go out of your comfort zone. Do whatever you possibly can to put your opponent out because you know they're fighting just as hard as you are.
When you get out of your comfort zone, you do something off the game plan, suddenly you could go into dangers you're not aware of.
Roberto Cruz going for pump handle, down to that body slam, in for the cover. And another kick out.
Looked like he put a dent in the ring in that body slam. I'm surprised Bam Grizzlee was able to kick out. He's still in this.
Oh, but a knee right to the face.
This.
What has he got playing?
Oh! Some sort of twisting flapjack maneuver.
One, two, and another kick out. I thought for sure that was the end. I thought Bam had this sealed up for sure.
Roberto is not letting anything.
Oh!
That's what I was telling earlier, the intelligence Roberto Cruz, you cannot just stand on this guy and think he's not alive. He's always gonna be fighting this match.
He's calling for a brain buster.
This was going to be over. This was going to be the last one.
But Roberto Cruz, being the sore loser that he is, will not accept a loss. And using that gold chain to choke out Bam Grizzlee. This is just despicable. And now choking him, getting a foot on his throat. The referee, Laura Phoenix, trying to exclaim to him to break it up.
I mean, let's face it, this is going to be the final battle, and it ends with a roll-up of all things. He wanted to make sure one of them, either him or himself, be completely knocked out. Essentially, Roberto Cruz lost by technicality. This is nowhere near over as far as he's concerned.
I mean, if they're going to call it the finish of the feud, and it ends in a roll-up, that's just how it ends. It's a decisive win in the record books. Roberto Cruz just can't handle the fact that Bam beat him.
It's not a decisive win. I don't know what you're doing with your adjectives there.
It was very decisive. Did you see both of Cruz's shoulders down? Hey, wait a minute. We see Bam Grizzlee's uncle. This is Uncle Reaver. What is he doing here?
Shouldn't he be at a bar somewhere, getting drunk?
Wrestling a bear, maybe? Oh! And a little bit of tandem offense coming from the family. Bam Grizzlee and his uncle coming out strong. And Cruz stumbling down. Bam asking for the microphone.
We got the time. My bad. We're going to feel really close to you. Now take it out of this question. This ain't going to end like this, Cruz. This ain't going to end like this. You made this personal. More than one time. All I ask for the IWE president to give me a chance to get you an all-headed, good old-fashioned dog collar match.
A dog collar match?
What? You
and
ain't
he's
gonna
saying
jump
yes.
me from behind, cause buddy, Mongo Reaver's in top now, baby. Oh yeah. So you want some? Come get some. Ooh-wee.
Wow. You want a decisive end? That'll be your decisive end. A dog collar match. From Bram, a dog collar match. Going out from Bam Grizzlee to Roberto Cruz, and it looks like we got an agreement with from our IWE president, Rick Green. It looks like that match will be made official. So the next time we see those two in a match together, it's going to be the true end, the decisive end that you're looking for between Roberto Cruz and Bam Grizzlee.
That's exactly what I want. A final true battle, not a roll up, just a complete assault back and forth. That's what you want in professional wrestling.
Making their way to the ring. And there he is, Mike Goodman, PI, leading the way.
We talk about perhaps the most lawful organization in IWE, the most trustworthy organization in IWE. I lost my dog once, they found it in 20 seconds. It was amazing.
Did you say 20 seconds?
Yeah. It was like, when I went up to him, it was like, I lost my dog, can you find it? And like, he just pulled it out from behind his back. It was
amazing.
Are you
sure he didn't just steal the dog?
No, he's...
And then when you called him out, he gave it back?
No, no. They're just too lawful to do something like that. They'll never break the law. What are you talking about? They protect the law. They are the law of IWE.
Together, trying to figure out what to do with this conundrum that they're in.
Clearly, Baker does not think Simon Page should be in this match.
You know, I think you could beat that guy.
Nick Baker stepping up.
He's going to do it solo. No Leviticus Abel.
Page walking back around, looks defeated.
I mean, in fairness, pretty sure Baker could probably handle this situation without Abel. What am I kidding, man? Even with Abel, he would be getting his crud beaten down. We're talking about the Goodman Detective Agency. You're talking the Hammer Bros. The Hammers. Chuck, Mongo.
Is none of your business. In this corner, Chuck and Mongo Hammer.
This will be the first time we see Chuck and Mongo Hammer working
and
together as a tag team. Pitted against them. And it looks like we're having Mongo Hammer start off.
As we saw, Mongo made his in-ring debut. Well, in action. I don't really want to count the Rumble because there was so much chaos there. But you really look at Mongo had an in-ring debut with Scotty Freytown and Mike Goodman in six-man tag.
And continually trying, Mongo, a strong man, trying hard to bring it, Nick Baker down with those shoulder tackles, but unable to do so, which leads into a drop toe hold, which leads into a scoop slam by Baker. Baker now, big body splash, in for the, the rolling pin.
That's a lot of rolling going around. Mongo needs to tag in the big man, Chuck Hammer.
And now a tag mate, Chuck Hammer coming in. Baker really showing his prowess right now. The King of Confections shows that he can cook up a plan to beat these odds, beat this handicap. And
Chuck,
wait a minute, oh.
Chuck just catch him, throw him back in the corner, knocking Mongo off. That was just a lot of beef being thrown back at Mongo.
Absolutely. Just the momentum alone of hitting that corner was enough to knock Mongo off. And now Mongo, the legal man again. The referee had a count of three backing Mongo off. And Nick Baker in a bad spot, stuck in the corner of the Hammer Bros. And a headbutt by Mongo. Nick Baker falling hard to the mat.
And Mongo just teasing the fans while he just irates, and in front of Simon Page as well. And here comes Chuck.
Now just really wrenching in that choke.
And Mongo back in. Really keeping themselves fresh. And usually you see them try and keep, in tag team action, try and keep their opponent in their corner. But this entire ring is their corner right now.
Absolutely. Oh!
The strength of Mongo Hammer, my goodness.
Just lifting Baker up like he was nothing. My lord. What a slam. And a tag to Chuck. And a strike right to the jaw of Baker now from Chuck.
As Mongo was holding him down with the beard. Interesting tactic Mongo has, and Chuck now putting all his weight onto the Baker.
And Mike Goodman talking, distracting our referee, Laura Phoenix.
He's just making sure that she knows that Simon Page is there. Try and keep Simon Page out. Oh boy.
Wait a minute. This match is taking a weird shift at the moment. Bill Blackwell out ringside now as Mongo Hammer continues to work on Baker. Chuck and Blackwell jawjacking back and forth at the moment.
We've seen those two big bulls go at it before.
Oh, what a shoulder from Mongo.
It looked like he just bounced right off after that shoulder.
Blackwell watching on to ensure that nothing bad happens to Baker, nothing suspicious. And wait a minute. The referee.
Here comes Blackwell.
Blackwell's had enough at this point. He's trying to make sure the rest of Mike Goodman and Pope do not interfere any more of this match and try to damper the chances of Nick Baker any more than they already are.
I mean,
but
really
still staying within the rules of the match, Blackwell not getting involved.
I mean, no one's been getting involved. It's just been the Hammer Bros hammering down on Nick Baker the most of this match.
Nick Baker now taking a moment, knocking Chuck off the ropes.
He almost relied on the fans there.
Oh!
Whoa!
Carry into like a rolling senton straight into the corner. One, two, three. That's the end of the match.
And the winners are Chuck and Mongo Hammond.
Again, showing that strength from Mongo. How impressive was that?
I did not expect that whatsoever. Lifting him up on the shoulders, he lost his balance there. But the amount of impact he did to Nick Baker finished that match. We're going to take another look at the strength of this man as he lifted Nick Baker up and just put him down the ground. Almost took out Laura Phoenix there in the process.
Just two big men. Laura Phoenix had nowhere to go. But Blackwell coming into the ring to ensure that Mike Goodman and his goons do not continue the assault on Nick Baker after the win.
Stop saying goons.
Employees?
I'll take employees. Right. I'll do employees. In the meantime, we're going to send it right back as Shelby Ingalls was able to talk to D&D and really to see how they feel about their current reign as the tag team champions.
Roll.
Round check success.
I want you guys to shine up those real nice and keep them warm for us because we're taking them on the next episode.
They're
They're going to be real warm on our mantle tonight.
Whatever you say. Anyways, we'll see you next episode. Right. Cody and I, we got to leave anyways. We have a prayer conference in Providence. So.
Yeah. Hey, don't worry.
Back to your games, nerds.
You'll need God on your side.
Those
I guess that says it right there. The Sons of Sanity going to be running and gunning for these.
You're pretty. You do a good job.
You're a sweetheart. Don't ever change.
And now for another match I personally am excited to see. Another singles competition with two new stars that we've had here in IWE. Guys that debuted in our Rumble match. This is Tyler Dean.
That's right, Tyler Dean, more of the luchadore-esque style. Loves to fly around and likes to be thrown around in the ring, considering he's not going to do very well, I imagine, against his opponent. But Tyler Dean, I'll give him credit. This little fourth grader is going to probably impress a few people.
He put on a decent showing at the Rumble. I'm excited to see what he's capable of in a singles match here. But he's going to have a clash of styles as he's going up against Caesar Ashur.
Ashur. Yes. I mean, this is a new talent, new to a lot of people at the IWE, and a fantastic professional wrestler. Music, it just moves my soul.
Whatever.
And already taunting Tyler Dean before this match even gets underway.
And here we go, this matchup is underway.
As you're saying, a clash of styles. The high-flying style of Tyler Dean taking on the grappling style of Caesar Ashur.
And Caesar's showing that he has all the confidence in the world and sees Tyler Dean as absolutely no threat as they sized up and Caesar just pushed him back. Straight on the assault as he dodged the collar elbow tie-up into some straight kicks.
Using that speed and quickness is what he's going to have to do against Caesar.
And again, doing the same thing, showing how clever he can be at the same time as quick. And that might have to be his recipe for success here as he tries to take down someone that greatly outsizes him. Oh! Shoulder tackle from Caesar. In the clothesline. Tyler Dean flipping through that hip toss, landing on his feet and leaping back up enough to get a drop kick in.
He knew exactly where he was and his opponent was. I give him credit. That was impressive. But the schoolyard hijinks can only last for so long against Caesar.
And now in for immediate cover. And it looks like Caesar's just trying to like outpower him, just hold him down, whether he has an attack on him or not. And now bringing him back to his feet, sending him through the second rope. What does Caesar have planned here? Oh, but Dean fighting back. Oh, and over the ropes goes Ashur. To the top rope goes Tyler Dean. I don't know what he has planned.
I'm Tyler Dean, like I said.
And he gets caught. He got caught by Caesar.
Oh.
Caesar's takedown of Huracanrana that sent Caesar right into the steel bars of the apron of the ring.
My goodness, the power of Caesar Ashur catching him like that at the outside the ring. But then the wherewithal of Tyler Dean has sent him into the ring apron. My goodness, that was ridiculous.
The back and forth on the outside. The big move to big move. I cannot believe what we just watched. And now both men back in the ring. Caesar again showing his power by catching Dean and up and down. One, two, and another kick out after two. Tyler Dean staying in it.
The sidewinding slam onto Tyler Dean just wasn't enough, but that is taking a lot of the confidence, a lot of the air out of Tyler Dean as Ashur is in full control, driving those shoulders of him in the corner.
And Caesar bringing Tyler Dean up to the top rope as he goes up to the second. Looks like he's planning for a superplex, but Dean now fighting back. Right hand, right to the head. Oh, and Caesar tied up on the ropes. And a double stomp, double stomp. And he pulls the legs way far away from the ropes. And another kick out. These two men, these two gladiators putting on a show for these fans right now.
Absolutely fantastic match we're seeing between Caesar Ashur and Tyler Dean. Ashur still alive. What?
Oh!
I thought he was gonna throw him in the pants there for
a
second.
Just right off the ropes. And another kick out by Dean. Caesar arguing with the referee, saying it was three.
And the referee was in pretty poor position there. He has no idea if his shoulder was down for all three.
I mean, you saw it just as well as I did. He kicked out after two, and a huge Irish whip into the corner. Caesar still on the assault.
And right in front of us, grazing those eyes across the top rope.
Pushing the referee. He's got to be careful. He'll get himself disqualified. And belly to belly suplex. In for the cover again. One, two, and another kick out. Another cover. Oh no, just an assault.
Just keeping the offense going, that is what Ashur needs to do, because it seems like Dean is not going to go away so easily.
But how impressive is this showing nonetheless, the heart, the spirit this kid has. You say he's small, I say he's got the biggest heart around.
I mean, you can't tell me he's not small.
Well, it's all determined on scale. I mean, depending on what you put him next to.
The man's 4'2".
What does Caesar have planned here? Going for a moonsault and missing! Caesar, high risk, no reward.
He was entering the district of Tyler Dean there, but I'm not sure he really had a full concept. Maybe try and win against Tyler in his own game, but now Tyler's got something to be up.
Right into the corner.
What is he?
He's setting up on the top rope again.
Asher's on the other side of the ring. What is Tyler?
Oh, went for what to be a DDT. He hits him with a tornado DDT. Caesar again catching him. But again, Tyler Dean ready to take it to the next level. Pushing himself to the limit.
Ashur needs to take a breather here.
What? Up and around!
The 313!
Going up to the ropes, the top of the ropes, one more time he's going for it. He wants to finish this. That seated senton!
The thumb coast pop out of Tyler Dean. Everything is going Dean's way. Ashur needs to wake up. He's got to shake those cobwebs away.
After all the damage he's taken, it's surprising he can still get to his feet. Up and over. Tugging the clothesline. Roll up.
I'm going to give it up to Tyler Dean. That was an amazing fight. I thought he had absolutely no shot, but he made me a believer for a quick second. And I realized
he made you a believer multiple times in that match.
But then I realized he's wrestling Cesar Ashur, a man who has definitely succeeded in every form of combat sports. But, you know, we've seen a lot of great talents come out of IWE last year. These two could be very easily future new Superstar of the Year.
Yeah.
New Gladiator of the Year. Yeah.
Looks to be a these two men, so much bad blood. They're just going back and forth. This isn't even a match. This is just a beating. A Wicked wanted a fight, and he's getting it.
There's Rick Caurdiea.
Wait a minute here. Rick Caurdiea coming out.
That music. JJ, Wicked, this does not need to happen. I don't want to see it. And it might be a good match, but as friends, I don't think these people want to see it. I have known you two since you broke into the business. You are the best of friends, and this does not need to happen.
What's going on here, Chris? What is this about? This has nothing to do with you.
This is definitely boiling over, not just between JJ and Wicked, but Rick's getting a little frustrated now between these two.
Wait a minute here. These three now looking back at each other. Oh! And the referee's calling for the bell. We got a triple threat match here. An impromptu triple threat match. The IWE Gladiator Champion A Wicked, JJ Hughes, old school Rick Caurdiea. We have a main event here for the ages.
Definitely going to be a huge match between these three.
One, two, and A-Wicked breaking up that pin from Rick Caurdiea.
It's really the frustration between JJ and Wicked boiling into Rick Caurdiea. Rick grew up on the road, well, not grew up, but he's traveled the road with these guys for so long. He hates the fact that these two just have been beating each other, that greed has been forcing them between them.
What's interesting about this, how how this is played out is Rick Caurdiea came out to try to help friends, to try to tie the broken bonds that they've had. But now he finds himself in a triple threat match where if he pulls off the victory here, he might see himself in contention for the Gladiator Championship.
The former Gladiator Champion, shortest reigning champion in IWE history, and the longest losing streak in IWE history. That's
also longest winning streak in IWE.
Debatable.
What do you mean debatable?
Oh, still kicking out Rick Caurdiea from this match, and Caurdiea, you just see he's growing frustrated from this.
Wicked and Hughes just don't want him in any part of this. This is a fight between former brothers, former friends, and dropkick sends Hughes straight through the second rope. Wicked now.
What is Wicked
doing? Going up to the top rope, up and down. Showing where he's comfortable, flying high, taking out both old-school Rick Caurdiea and J.J. Hughes.
We're taking a quick look at that again. My goodness, this is absolutely ridiculous in the slow-mo style. I mean, Wicked putting it all on the line against J.J. Hughes and Rick Caurdiea in this triple threat contest.
And really taking it to Hughes right now, and again, knocking Caurdiea off the apron, making sure he doesn't get back in the ring for this match. And a leg lariat from A. Wicked in for the cover. One, two, and Caurdiea trying to get back in the ring, but A. Wicked broke his own cover to make sure Caurdiea did not get involved.
This kid has not been thinking straight. He's been getting such a big ego since winning the Gladiator title.
It's not even just ego, just his emotions are running wild with what's been happening between him and Hughes. He can't think straight.
Foot straight in the stomach, and you're looking Wicked now, they're gasping for air.
And now adding injury to more injury. Those strikes right to the chest. Again, Caurdiea. He just can't seem to get himself involved in this match.
And it just seems to be building the frustration for him. Meanwhile, we were having an excellent match just between these two.
Oh, and the Hughes effect! The Hughes effect from J.J. Hughes in for the cover! And Caurdiea breaking it up.
Caurdiea finally being able to get back in this match.
Right when it looked like Hughes had it won.
Apparently, I said that too soon.
Promptly thrown right back out.
Wicked.
Oh! It looked like he was going for a cover and decided not to. He wants to make sure Hughes is out for good at this point. He's going to his comfort zone. He's going to the top rope. Oh, and Hughes stopping that.
Hughes
promptly
playing it smart, knocking him down, and he got hit in an area no one wants to get hit. Completely legal in this kind of situation with top ropes.
And a chop. Oh, wait a minute, what's going on here?
Caurdiea's taking advantage, whatever's going on. Wicked was climbing to the top.
What do we got going on here? Oh! And all three men flying flat on the mat after that ridiculous Tower of Doom style maneuver.
We had a spider German suplex from J.J. Hughes on Rick Caurdiea, but Caurdiea delivered a huge superplex from the top rope. I mean, it's no wonder all three of these individuals are down. And you just gotta know, considering the Gladiator champions in here, J.J. Hughes and now the former Gladiator champion, Rick Caurdiea, that,
both men are pinning Rick Caurdiea, and Caurdiea kicks out.
I was gonna say, you know, Pure Fury Jeff Klaus must be watching this match at home, taking notes from J.J. and Wicked.
Oh!
And Rick, cleaning house right now.
Jesus! These strikes coming from these competitors have bad blood written all over it. Oh! And right into the corner went Hughes. And now Caurdiea is sending Wicked into the opposite corner. It looks like he's got plans. Taking out Hughes, backing it up, and then taking out Wicked. In for the cover. One, two. And it looked like Wicked kicked out and hit Lors. Lors on the pin. One, two.
Rick Caurdiea could have potentially won this match, but the referee was out of position there.
She was out of position because she was ensuring us that the previous was a two count, but a super kick from A. Wicked to Hughes.
Caurdiea, though, he's still fighting into A. Wicked. Go for the caddy ride.
And hits it strong. One, two, three. Rick Caurdiea wins with a blast from the past. Coming for Rick Caurdiea. And hitting the Gladiator champion.
That's what I was gonna say. He just pinned the Gladiator champion, A. Wicked. This just means far more getting the victory versus getting it over JJ Hughes.
I mean, at this point, you can only assume that there at no point does the bad blood stop here between Hughes and Wicked. None of that ended. And then on top of that, Caurdiea now picking up a win over Wicked puts himself in that title picture. And now that three-way dance we had previously is looking like a fatal four-way.
It's absolutely true. With that said, A. Wicked is still Gladiator champion. That was a non-title match.
Absolutely.
With that said, thank you all for joining us here for BattleZone TV.
I am Tommy Danger Z, and I'm happy to be your host this evening. I can't wait to see you next episode.
And I am the professional Sean Lathrop. Good night, good fight.